All right, let's wait for a second for that to warm up and make sure that's going to work. Good morning, everyone. Thanks for joining me this morning. We're going to get started. I'm already a little late. My name is Tim Coyer. I have had the pleasure of leading worship for you guys here this weekend. I lead at Catalyst Covenant Church, which is a church plant that's about a year and a half old. We meet about a mile and a half from here. In a coffee shop at a Lutheran seminary. And it's been a great year and a half. So I'm excited to be here this morning with all of you. And I grew up in a church, I grew up in Vista Covenant Church, which is a town and a cornfield. Maybe some of you can relate. Southern Minnesota, a town of just over 1,000 people. And our church was 5 miles out of town. And it was a fantastic experience for me growing up. I left Vista, I actually served. Vista was the first church I served at in a vocational role as a youth director. Left there, came to the Twin Cities to finish my degree at Bethel, Bethel College here, Bethel University. Served in a few other covenant churches in youth and in worship prior to being at Catalyst. I was at Salem Covenant Church, which is one of the larger churches here in the Twin Cities. Also about 125 years old in the contemporary worship there. So I'm really happy to be here this morning. If you need to ask questions, if we're in the middle, be like, hey, Tim, you just said something. Can you repeat that? I am A-okay with interruptions. I will try to be proactive about asking you guys some questions or maybe trying to get you guys involved in what we're doing. So the format for this morning, I kind of was talking to John and going, I could really do heartfelt worship is a really broad topic, really. I could spend an hour just on a theology of what heartfelt worship is, which might be fantastic, and some of you may love that, but also you might go home going well, that's awesome, but what do I do with that? Or I could try to come up with here's the 10 steps to having heartfelt worship at your church, and that might be really helpful, but it's probably not going to fit your church. So each of you come from a unique culture and unique experience, and so hopefully we can talk about both of those things. A little bit of why we do what we do, how and what we do what we do, and maybe there's some practicality in that as well. So, everybody good? All right. This is not the best setup for this, but we're going to make it work. These three things are not new. If you've been on the Covenant website, or if you've seen even the little Vitality brochure that is in your book, whenever it talks about heartfelt worship, they list three qualities of what heartfelt worship is. We exalt and celebrate God for who He is, what He has done, what He is doing, and what He will do. Worship reflects careful preparation to help give voice to many dimensions of response to God, such as adoration, praise, contrition, lament, and commitment. And people leave worship knowing something more about the heart of God and about their own hearts. These three lines, phrases, are the things we're going to center our time around this morning, kind of digging a little deeper on all three of those things. And so that's kind of where we're headed this morning. I'm going to intermix this with what has become, where did I put my water bottle down? Over here. What has become for me kind of my, a statement about how and how I do worship. It actually is something that I've borrowed and changed from a friend of mine who was a worship leader at a large congregation here in the Twin Cities. And one Sunday, a gentleman came up to him after church and says, well, it seems like you need an electric guitar player, because they didn't have one that day. And my friend goes, well, yeah, I guess we do need one, because we didn't have one. And so the guy's like, well, I'll come play next week then. And so he came the next week on Sunday morning wearing sunglasses and a Hawaiian floral shirt. It turns out this guy was a studio musician in the Twin Cities. Fantastic electric guitar player, but rockabilly and surf songs were his thing. And so if their worship team were doing Beach Boy cover tunes, he would have fit in fantastically, but they weren't. It was the early 90s. Everyone was trying to sound like U2. And he didn't fit. He didn't fit their culture, and he wasn't coachable. And so they had to end up getting rid of him, which always is never fun. And it caused my friend to ask a question, what do we need for worship? And so he kind of started this, and I've expanded it. And this is what he says, and I agree with him, that we need for worship. We need the people of God hungry for the Word of God. And this is primarily what we're talking. We're going to talk a little bit about, I'm guessing we're here this morning to talk about Sunday morning worship, and we could have a whole, 5-day seminar on how worship isn't just about Sunday mornings, and we'll talk about that this morning as well. But we're primarily focusing this morning on a Sunday morning experience. The people of God, hungry for the Word of God, singing a song of truth in the same key at the same time. That's what we need for worship to happen. There's all other layers, and this is kind of, for me, this is something I've been tweaking a lot lately, and this may be something that I'm feeling like there's going to be a time in the near future where there's going to be new additions for me, but this is where I'm at now. The people of God, hungry for the word of God, singing a song of truth in the same key at the same time are some of the elements we need to have worship. So we're going to start with this idea of celebrating God's story. So the first attribute, they call it heartfelt worship again, we celebrate, we exalt and celebrate God for who he is, what he has done, what he is doing, and what he will do. What we're talking about is primarily a response. Our worship is a response to something God has done in preparation for things that he will do. This is what I call the people of God hungry for the word of God. I don't know how about you guys felt last night. I thought last night was, and this is not like because I was the worship leader, I thought last night was a really sweet time of worship together. I really felt like the congregation that has assembled this weekend, we really kind of cohesed? Yeah, we're going to go with that. Cohesed. Yeah, came together in a way that doesn't always happen for people who come from all over the country. There was a cohesion. There we go. I made it. That happens, and I think this is partially what happens is your people, I'm guessing, the people who are here are people who care about their church. You wouldn't have given up a weekend, and for some of you flown across the country, if you were just a bystander at your church. I'm guessing you are all deeply involved in your church, whether it's in an official capacity, on a board, on a worship team, whether it's an unofficial leader, you're volunteering, but it's kind of like how John told the story this morning about the woman who goes up to someone else and just says, this is not how we do things here. I'm guessing you are people who are pouring yourselves out. And that's a key element for coming together for worship. Rob Bell gave a sermon a few years ago that has really impacted me, where he talks about if we are the body of Christ, Christ was broken and poured out for his people, and we as a church, we as Christians are called to be broken and poured out for the sake of the gospel, for the sake of the world that Christ is calling us to, for the sake of the kingdom. And that is a key element for worship. I think that's why the worship last night, and the worship this weekend has been so great. It's not because I'm so awesome. It's not because like the worship team's really good, even though my friends are really good musicians. It's because the Holy Spirit is in this place. It's because people have come here hungry for the word of God, hungry to hear about a new vision for their church, and hungry to worship together. For some of you, if you're on your worship teams, I'm guessing you don't always get a chance to worship very often. It's probably really wonderful to come and be fed. Sometimes I know it's not always true. Like, there's always the bit of me as a worship leader when I go someplace else, and I almost kind of wish I was the one leading worship. Like, you ever have that moment? Something I'm working on in myself, or like, I would have done that differently. And it just takes me out of the moment. That's something I'm working on. So I think our worship requires homework. And it is, like we said, we're talking mostly about Sunday mornings. Worship is not primarily about Sunday mornings. Worship is 1 hour a week on Sunday mornings, maybe an hour and a half if you're lucky, if you don't have a football game at noon. Worship needs to be about more than just that 1 hour. And it needs to be about our churches having people who come on Sunday mornings hungry for God's word, people who have poured themselves out in order to be filled back up. I want to talk a little bit about worship in the Old Testament particularly. There are a couple different words in Hebrew that we translate as worship. The first one is shachah. Its literal translation is to bow down. It is a posture of worship that is very humbling. To bow down before someone who is so great. An example comes out of Psalm 66. All the earth will worship you and will sing praises to you. They will sing praises to your name. All the earth will bow down before you. When we see your face, our response is to put our faces on the ground before you. Another word the Old Testament uses for worship is abad, which is service. Means to serve. So from Exodus 3, and he said, certainly I will be with you, and this shall be a sign to you that it is I who have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you shall worship God at this mountain. You shall serve God at this mountain. Those are the two words the Old Testament uses most to talk about worship. And these are not corporate gatherings. These are not talking about, like, let's get together and sing five songs and read a scripture and have a sermon and sing one more song. Okay? This is primarily about being humble before God and serving God and one another. Worship primarily happens outside of Sunday mornings in the way we are breaking ourselves and pouring ourselves out. There are places, the Old Testament talks about corporate places of worship. They use this word yare, to fear. And it comes in places where it says like this, because these people draw near with their mouths and honor me with their lips, while their hearts are far from me, and their worship of me is a human commandment learned by rote. When the Old Testament time often talks about corporate gatherings of worship, it is not a positive description. They worship me, but their hearts were far from me. Our worship needs to begin Monday morning in pouring ourselves out, in bowing to God before Him, making ourselves humble, serving those around us, becoming hungry for God's Word. So that when we do gather together, we are ready to hear God's Word. We are ready to worship together as a community. All right. How fast am I going? I can slow down a little bit. Everybody feeling good? I tend to talk fast. And so really just like, it's my wife's job when I preach to be like, Tim, like slow it down. So raise your hand if you're like, Tim, can you just chill for a second? I thought I had another slide here. I guess I don't. All right. So we're going to move on to the next area. And as we wrap this area up, I just want to impress, like, again, we're moving primarily to talk about Sunday mornings. There is something about our worship that is beyond that. And that is something that our churches need to learn more and more, that we call worship and we say we're worshiping and we're saying we're going to sing three songs together, as opposed to a life of worship and service, as opposed to a worship service that might be an hour and a half long that contains more things than just that, you know, opening song set at the beginning. So we expand the vocabulary of worship for our congregation in our preparation, and we expand the ideas of what worship can be. Our services should have time to reflect on who God is and hear the stories of what God has done. So if you're serving each outside of the congregation, outside of Sunday mornings, let's have time to come together and share those stories. Worship needs to be done more than just a thing we do for an hour on Sunday. Our churches need to be serving together. That should be serving, not service together. And it's more than just the songs we sing. Finding ways for our church to worship together outside of that 1 hour where we are working together. Our church has done a couple things in the last few months that have been really fun. One, actually, this morning, there's an organization in the Twin Cities called Feed My Starving Children. They pack these little meals in plastic bags of rice, a soy product, a chicken flavoring, and dehydrated vegetables. It's a vegetarian chicken flavoring. And you pack it all together, you seal it in a vacuum seal bag, you put a bunch in a box, and they send these boxes to missionaries in Africa, in Haiti, where people don't have food. And it's been designed by engineers at General Mills to, Cargill? General Mills? One of the two. To have all the nutrients you need for a day. And this one pack costs like 25 cents to make, feeds 6 people for 1 day. And so our church is there this morning, serving together. This morning, this summer, we partnered with a local youth organization bringing in school supplies. That's not original. I'm guessing lots of churches do similar kind of things, but it's a way that you're serving together. And that happens on Sunday mornings, but it makes you aware that you are pouring yourselves out together.
Right now, we're working on the Operation
Shoebox. Yeah, the Operation Christmas Child, or whatever. Yeah.
Shoeboxes.
Yeah, you bring in shoeboxes with toys and for an age. Yeah, and there's a lot of, like, it's Angel Tree. Is that one of the other Christmas ones? A lot of kind of like that, where you can partner with local organizations and... That would be awesome. All right, so we're going to move on to the second area that I'm calling, I'm kind of titling worship preparation. This is the second element they talk about, heartfelt worship. Worship reflects careful preparation to help give voice to many dimensions of response to God, such as adoration, praise, contrition, lament, and commitment. And this is kind of that second half of kind of my phrase, where I'm saying it's singing a song of truth in the same key at the same time. I'm always surprised. I, for about a year and a half, wasn't serving in a church, and I was kind of I like to call myself a free agent. I was on my free agency tour for about a year and a half, and I would get called by churches around and be like, oh, man, worship leader is going to be gone this week. Can you come fill in? And it was actually a lot of fun, and it was a great transition leaving the church I'd been at for 7 years and had a year and a half where I got to experience a lot of different things, large and small churches. It was a lot of fun. But I was always surprised the churches where I called them up And they call me, and I'm like, okay, when's rehearsal? And it's always, well, rehearsal is at 7 o'clock, service is at 8. And it always kind of blew my mind. It's like, so you're saying I've never played with any of your musicians before. They play together, but I've never played with them. And we have an hour to, like, learn 4 songs together. You can do it, and I've done it. I'm sure many of you, I mean, we've all done things like that in the past, if you've been involved in churches. It's not ideal. Our worship requires preparation. There are churches and practices that go into services with zero preparation, and that might be their style of liturgy. But it does require us putting some thoughtfulness into our worship services. It does require us not just showing up and saying, well, what 4 songs do we want to sing today? Well, I like this one, and I like this one, I like this one, and then I like this one. Let's do those 4 songs, and trying to make them into something. Requires us preparing. And so we're going to spend a little bit of time kind of in these areas this morning. The songs we choose really matter. And you may have heard this before. I'm going to plug a couple times a Facebook group called Better Together. Anybody Better Togethers in the room? If you have a worship leader at your church or someone who kind of leads your worship ministry, they should get part of this. Friend me on Facebook, and I will invite you in. We have a closed Facebook group of covenant worship leaders where all kinds of crazy things happen. We encourage each other. We intentionally try to leave, like, senior pastors out. So if you need to come in on Monday morning and go, I got to tell you this stupid thing my senior pastor said yesterday, and vent, or you're saying, I need help with this situation, do you guys have some advice? It's a great community for... sometimes, like, working in churches can be kind of lonely because you're the only worship guy at your church, and you can talk to other people, but it's not that same community. And so we've kind of grown up together, this group called Better Together. So you have to be allowed in. You can't just show up and be a part of it. So look for us and ask in. These are some examples. I want to talk a little bit this morning about thinking theologically about the songs we sing. There's something about when we stand up and sing words that allow them to stick in our brain in different ways. There's something about our brain chemistry that affects us more than just hearing the word, more than just even standing up and saying the word. When we put it to music, there's something that affects our brains in pretty powerful ways. And in many, many cases, the theology of your worship songs are far more important than the theology of the things you preach. Theology of the things that are on your website that say, we believe these things. Because it's the practical theology of your church. It's a practical theology where people are going to go home, and you might remember, like, the one key phrase your pastor said that morning. But they've done studies. Most people forget most of the sermon within 20 minutes. And that's for good. That's for, like, pastors like Rick Warren, like, really good, impactful pastors. We don't just remember the things that we hear. But you will. How many times do you find yourself Wednesday morning humming the song you sang Sunday morning? It happens all the time. These are some examples, actually, and why I bring up Better Together is these are actual conversations we've had on this Facebook page that I really love. So somebody a couple weeks ago posted a question and said, how do you guys feel about a song that has the arrogance to say, Holy Spirit, you are welcomed here? Yeah. And we had a really fruitful conversation about the song. We sang it last night, Holy Spirit. Obviously, I feel very comfortable singing that song because I led it for you last night. But it's worth having a conversation to think about, how do we feel about the Holy Spirit and what it's doing here? And who are we talking to when we say, Holy Spirit, you are welcome here? I don't think we're talking to the Holy Spirit. I think we're talking to ourselves. And that is a just fine thing to do on a Sunday morning, is sing to myself, Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. We know our theology tells us the Holy Spirit is already in the place. Two or more are gathered. The Holy Spirit is here. What we're saying is, Holy Spirit, soften me so I feel you move. And the rest of the song talks about that. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. It's worth having that discussion. Another infamous one comes from the song In Christ Alone. In the second verse, there's this line. It says, the wrath of God was satisfied. This is kind of an infamous one where people talk about songs in worship. This is a very... we'll get a little theological. Talks about a substitutionary theory of atonement. Substitutionary penal substitutionary theory of atonement. And it's actually kind of not the way the covenant historically has talked about what Christ did to save us. There's this, well, I'm not going to go deep into like the P.P. Waldenstrom, but he kind of basically, he's one of the really famous covenant theologians who kind of, his big contribution to theology was to say that God's posture towards us did not change in what Christ did on the cross. God has always felt the same way about us. God's wrath was not there before and now it's gone. God has always loved us, and we are the ones who now can approach him because of that. And so it's worth having a question to say, do we think that Christ's work on the cross, that the wrath of God was satisfied? And so do we sing that song? There are some who go ahead and change the words to that song to something else. I have to tell you, it is illegal to do that, just so you know. People do it anyway. I've done it. Everybody does it. It is copyright violation to change the words to a song you do not own or without the express written consent of the author. It happens. There's a great, famously happened, I think it was either midwinter or an annual meeting where they changed the words to the song. They sang it one night, the original way, sang it the next night because everybody got their stuff in arms. Well, that's not really how we feel about atonement. And then everybody's like, you just sang that song in front of a few thousand people. It's actually a copyright violation. We could get in trouble. And so that song actually isn't sung at many covenant events anymore because we have a slight disagreement with the theology. And we don't want to change the word and make it and be illegal. I was actually joking because I did not lead worship last week at my church. I preached, and the guest worship leader did this song. She changed the words, and I was kind of giving her a hard time. But it happens.
Sam, I got a question.
Yeah.
Is it illegal to add verses to a song also?
I don't believe it's illegal to add verses. I would have to check that for sure, but I don't think that would be illegal.
So if you wrote your own verse to,
yeah,
in addition,
I think that would be fine. If it was like I wrote my own verse by taking the verse and changing every third word to something I liked, completely new, I don't think that would be a problem. I know some...
Because didn't they, on Amazing Grace, they changed something in Amazing Grace?
They've added, so a lot of times they'll add a chorus or something. Like that, there's the version of Amazing Grace, they added a chorus.
Yeah.
Some of that, though, once a song is 75 years old, it is in the public domain and you can do whatever you want with it. That's actually why they do that in those songs, because then that's how Chris Tomlin makes money. So he takes a song in the public domain, adds a chorus, and then, and it's awesome. And he copyrights it, and it's easy to be cynical about it. It's also an awesome
way to do that.
Yeah, it's fantastic. Yeah. But you can add, so part of that is some, if it's in the public domain, that's why they do it a lot with hymns, is they're going to add a chorus, they can already do it. But I do believe it's okay. Okay, excellent. And this is the last version. This actually came up really recently. There's a new song by Vertical Worship, and I'm not going to remember the name. And so somebody brought up, like, how do you, like, we sang the song yesterday, and I've decided we're not going to sing it anymore because of this very, like, almost sexual language about Jesus ravishing my heart and thinking about the culture we live in. Do we want to talk about Jesus in those terms? And we had a really deep conversation from all sides of the conversation with people saying, I'm totally fine with that. In fact, I think it's a great way to think about who God is and what he's done for us. There are people that's going to reach. And that's the question. There are very few, like, hard answers about a lot of these songs.
Crowder changed the words originally in...
For How He Loves?
But he
got permission. He called John Mark McMillan on the phone and said, can I change the words to that song? Yeah. That's the one, actually, where I break the law, because I heard that song before Crowder did it, and I'm like, I love the song, and the song is too good to throw away for that one line, and so we changed it to something else, and then I heard Crowder's version, and I probably would have gone with that if it had been an option, but I'm like, we've been singing it this way for a year. I know it's illegal. I'm going to... And we have conversations, and that's what's awesome about this Better Together page, and really, like, if you want to join in, like, we had a really interesting conversation about, like, do we care about the legal ramifications of changing that word, or is it worth it to us to sing this song? Like, that's the conversation to have. And there's some people going, like, God calls us to follow the laws. You got to follow the law. And some people going, like, on the other side, going, well, the Spirit's leading me to do this. Like, this is what God has called us to do. The song's too good to throw away for that one line. But that's the conversation you can have. But have the conversation. I was trying to find, because there are some of our hymns that do the same thing, that we just sing because they're in the blue hymnal, or they're in the red hymnal. But we need to have conversations about, like, just because it's in the red hymnal doesn't mean that everything is like perfectly theologically correct, or everything reflects our church and how we feel about what the song is saying. And so maybe you want to not do that verse of that hymn. And I was trying to find a good example, and I failed you all, and I'm sorry. But they're out there as well. So worship preparation. We think about the things we use. So I use that phrase, singing a song of truth. Like, I interviewed at a church a few years ago, and they just said, like, well, how do you feel about, like, singing non-church songs on Sunday morning? And I kind of went, like, I'm generally kind of okay with that as long as it points to God, as long as it serves a purpose of telling God's story or moving us forward in God's story. And they're like, well, no, we just want to, like, do the song because it's, like, fun to sing. And I'm like, no, that's not really, I don't think that's why we're here on Sunday mornings. You can go do that Saturday night at any club in the city. That's not why we're here. I think there is something about the songs we sing. They don't have to be, like, in CCLI. They don't have to be, like, by Chris Tomlin or Hillsong. But they need to point us towards God's story, I think. And worship preparation. What is the role of a worship leader? Your church may or may not have a worship leader. I was talking to John Wenrick, and he's like, we have churches here this week who have 30 people. We have churches here this weekend who have like 600-some people. I'm guessing, though, that some of you play a role as worship leader in your church in some capacity. And really being a worship leader is everything from you're the guy who gets everyone together so that they do the worship. I have a friend who works at one of our covenant churches here in Minnesota. He is the head worship guy at their church. He is not a musician. He got the role because he was their production guy. It's a larger church. He's the guy you want on Sunday mornings if your soundboard breaks, because he will fix it for you. But he works with a great team of volunteer worship leaders, and he gets them the things they need so that worship happens. Or someone like myself, who I am the person who most weeks is the guy playing guitar and doing the singing, leading the congregation, thinking about doing a lot of preparation. And there's a lot of different roles that worship leaders play. And I want to talk a second about this producer versus director idea. There's a good show on HBO called Project Greenlight. And it is a documentary, actually reality TV, but they call it a documentary, about the making of a movie. Ben Affleck and Matt Damon select a young, new filmmaker and give them a $3 million project to do that's going to be on air on HBO. And I've been watching it this past season, and the director they chose is in his 20s. He comes off as like your typical millennial, kind of very a little full of himself, and needy and all kinds of things. And he is driven by his vision for the story we're telling. Everything is about telling the story. The big debate they had in the first episode is, can he shoot on film or shoot on digital? And it would cost $300,000 more to shoot on film. And he's like, well, we gotta shoot on film because it just feels better. And I just wanted to like throw up in his face because he's like kind of driving me nuts. But there is that creative bit of like being a director, being the creative person who has a vision for what we're doing, who's coming in, who has the idea that this is what the story we want to tell today. Let's tell God's story. Versus a producer. In this show, they have a producer. Her name is Effie. I have always been ambiguous about what a producer does on a movie set. I don't know about you. I'm always like, why do they get the Oscar for Best Picture? Why doesn't it go? Like, I always assumed, like, being kind of creative myself, but give it to the creative guy. It's his vision. It goes to the producer because they make it happen. The producer, the big fight they have is this producer is always the one who's like, we can't do that. It costs too much money. Like, this is our budget. I'm saving every penny I can for you to do your big car crash scene at the end, but we can't make a car flip 5 times because it's too dangerous and we don't have the money to do it. And then they have these clashes, these fights over who's right. But it's the producer's job to make it happen, to make all the things happen so the creative person can explore their vision. And as a worship leader, we often need to fill both roles. Or we need to find someone who can be the producer. Sometimes that might be the lead pastor. Sometimes that might be another volunteer who has some of those gifts. I've heard a couple times this summer from two different people I respect. One was Jon Stewart, as he was leaving The Daily Show this summer, was asked about kind of their creative process. And he talked about the necessity for boundaries in creativity. He's like, we are bound by time. Every day, we come to work and we have 8 hours to put together a show. So it'd be great to like just spend 8 hours like dreaming about all the things we could do, but we have to do something about it. There is a force that is compelling us forward. Or, and then the other was, Ed Catmull is the president of Disney Pixar. Talks about how important it is in their films to have boundaries. Pixar makes gazillions of dollars. If they wanted to make a movie that cost a gazillion dollars, they could, because they've just got it lying around. Between the movies, all the toys they sell, gazillions of dollars. But Ed knows that creativity doesn't happen well with no limits. And so they put budgets into their films. And it's constraining at times. Like, it's constraining to kind of go like, I really want to do like this, but I don't have the money to do it. But it causes you to be creative. I'm guessing for most of us, having gazillions of dollars isn't our problem. But having a tight budget does cause you to be creative. Having a tight budget does make you go like, well, what can we do with less? We'd really like to have a full rock and roll worship team. What we have is a piano player and somebody with a hand drum. Let's make that work. Because you can, and it can be beautiful. My mother and father-in-law pastor a small covenant church in South Dakota, and they had a high school student. He'd gone through a one-year Bible school program here in Minnesota, and then for the summer was back there before heading to North Park this fall. And he just kind of showed up one day and said, I'd love to lead worship. Didn't look like a worship leader, hadn't done it before. He'd grown up the church his whole life, had really just started playing guitar in the last year at this Bible college. And they're nervous about having this 19-year-old lead worship. Anybody been nervous about someone you let lead worship? All the time. I'm not leading worship at my church tomorrow. I have full, like, trust in the people who are doing it, but I'm still nervous for them, and it's just giving up that little bit of control I'm not good at. But they said, sure, you want to lead worship this summer. We don't have a lot of resources. My mother-in-law is the one leading worship, and she's like, I'd love to not do it for 3 months. Like, she doesn't feel that's her gifting, but it's the place she's been called to. And so they kind of let him do it, and they're thinking their main concern is that he's going to come in and pick songs they just can't do. That he's going to hear something, you know, the newest Hillsong, Young and Free, that's like a dance club tune. And he's going to try to, you know, make that happen on acoustic guitar. And he did a whole summer of basically hymns. That was the stuff he was drawn to. And they had a great, sweet time of worship this summer. And they were so sad when he had to leave to go to North Park. But the boundaries of their circumstance, they're in a small town. The nearest town is 20 miles away, and that's a small town. They don't have, like, the resources of, like, let's call the local college and see if there's a, you know, some guitarist who wants to come lead worship. This is what they had, and they worked, and it was awesome. Sometimes our boundaries can be really freeing, and that's sometimes the role we're called to do as a worship leader. Sometimes we're the director, we're the creative person who's like, let's do all of these things, and that tends to be where I do. Like, ideation is one of my top strengths. I like to just want to get out and be like, let's just spend all day like not doing anything concrete and just like, you know, look at the shiny things. That tends to be what I want to do, but usually I, you know, I've got a constraint on my time. I've got a constraint on my budget. There's a constraint of the time of the people I'm working with. Like, I need to let them, my worship team, know the songs we're singing and the things we're doing so they can prepare. I can't always do that. And that sometimes we play that role, director and a producer. We're called to be the cheerleader. We're the ones called to cheer on the ones who come up and lead worship with us. There's nothing worse than, like, serving in a role and never, like, having someone say, you did a good job today. It's often the primary of a job of a leader to say, good job, keep going. You're doing a great job. Even especially in the times when they fall flat on their face. Just say, because the cheerleaders on the football team are always there. It doesn't matter what the score is. They're always cheering. You might be getting your butts kicked in, but the cheerleaders are always there saying, good job, let's go. Go fight, win. Often our role as a worship leader. Includer. This is one that's hard for me. I'm taking some seminary classes, and we had a guest speaker from a local church, and her phrase that she used, and I like it, and I struggle with it, was that participation is the new excellence. That's the phrase at their church when they talk about worship. Participation is the new excellence. They're, instead of trying really hard to be like really perfect, they just want they want lots of people involved. And I love that idea. I think it's great. I also hate it. As someone who is a musician and wants to like do things really well, participation is actually really hard for me. I'm really happy to take my five friends and to like, let's just do us five all the time. Because I know it'd be awesome, and I know like we would like, there's something about like playing together with the same people, you gel, and things would be great, but then we'd lose out on so many new things. So our church is a year and a half old. I'd say about half the worship team are people I've worshiped with before. And so we're together now at this church. And the other half's the people who are new. And it has been so refreshing to add in new voices to what we're doing. It's still really hard for me when someone comes up after church on Sunday and goes, I like to sing. Can I sing on your worship team? And I'm always, like, my initial, like, internal reaction is like, no, you cannot. I don't know anything about you. But also, like, it's my job to go, like, yeah, let's get coffee. I'd love to hear what you sound like. Are you comfortable singing harmony? Like, what, these are some of the questions I like to ask. The first thing I always do is, I say, email me. Email me and let's chat. I tend to put the onus on the other person to say, like, I would love to have you involved, but I want to see, like, are you going to follow through? The thing that also drives me nuts is, like, when grandma comes in and goes, like, my grandson kind of plays bass. Would you call him? Like, he hasn't gone to church in a long time. Would you call him and see if he'd come? And I always say no. I'm kind of Minnesota nice, so I don't always, like, say directly, like, no. We don't like to be direct here in Minnesota. I'm sorry. Yeah. I'm working on it. But tend to, like...
That's how they do it in the South.
Yeah. I tend to want to put the onus on someone else, like, to say, can you follow through? Like, this is the first test of being on our worship team. All I'm asking you to do is email me, because I don't have your contact information. It's Sunday morning, I'm running around. I don't have time to, like, write it down. If I put it on a piece of paper, I'm going to lose it. And if you tell me your name and your email address, I'm going to forget it. My email address is in the bulletin. Take a bulletin home. Email me. I'd love to have coffee. And I'm always welcoming to new people when they come and ask if they want to be on the team. But, like my friend who had the guitarist who didn't fit, wasn't coachable, was really good, but didn't really have the spirit to be on a worship team. Got to be a little guarded of that at times.
How do you tell them it ain't gonna happen?
The best times is when they self-select out. So I have two qualifications to be on our worship team. Christ-like character and musical ability. And those are fluid definitions. So I had a gentleman on my last church on the worship team. We called him Uncle John because he was literally the uncle of the former worship leader. The sweetest man you've ever met. Just always the first one there, always the last to leave. Super helpful, horrible bass player. Like, just, like, not good. And if you hear John's story, John in his 20s was in a rock band that, like, it was like we just got signed, we were going to go on tour. John was in a car accident and was in a coma and spent the rest of his life kind of putting that back together. And in the last 15 years has been relearning how to play bass. So you could watch John, you know somewhere inside of him is an awesome bass player. It just doesn't usually come out. John was on the team before I got there. I didn't feel like I could fire John because John is part of the family. And so we found ways to minimize his damage. And then most of it was just kind of like, yeah. And most of the time he was fine. Once in a while he was not good. So there's some of that where, like, people are family and I don't feel like I can fire family. Sometimes people self-select out, and in the end that's happened with John, where John kind of said, like, I'm feeling like it's time for me to be done and move on. And I said, John, I celebrate that and support you and love you. Loved having you on the worship team. Blessings and whatever's next for you. But sometimes, yeah, it's just the hard conversation of, I'm sorry, but there's... And it's the things for me when it's like you fail at both. Like, that's where it actually kind of comes easy, of like, you're not a great musician, and you're kind of a diva when you're here. Or you're here to serve your... Yeah, and then, yeah, definition of diva. You're here to serve yourself, not the team. And that is never easy, but it's easier to go, like, well, there's cause to say, like... And some of that is just saying, like, let's try again in 6 months, maybe. Like, let's take a break. But this is it's trying to be direct with people. And I feel, honestly, very few times have I had to do that. I don't know if it's just I don't know what it is. Because you don't need to be an awesome singer to be on my worship team. Like, I don't need you to be, like, a lead soloist. I don't need you to be, like, a power soprano. But if you have a willing heart and you can sing some, like, that's kind of my thing of, like, can you sing some harmonies? Do you feel comfortable on occasion, like, leading a verse of this song? And not that those are, like, immediate disqualifiers, but most people can be on our team. Most people I've met who are musicians, who are instrumentalists, know a little bit. Like, I have not run into a lot of musicians, instrumentalists, who, like, have no clue about what they can or can't do. I had one drummer who played with us one time, and he just never called again. And that was kind of like, he showed up 1 week, And it was one of those, like, his mom was like, could you call Elliot and see if he'd come play with you guys? And I was just like, it was a week I didn't have a drummer. So I'm like, okay, we'll call Elliot this week. And it was not good. But had one guy. So my last church, we could talk about the paying musicians or not paying musicians. We had a we tended to not pay musicians, except for when we really needed it. Like, we felt like we could have, we had an idea of what we wanted our worship team to be. And there came a point where we no longer had a drummer. And we felt like that was important to us, and so we made a decision to set something in the budget to say we're going to pay a drummer. And so we, wasn't much, but we put a little bit of money aside and hired a drummer. And so there's a kid who's playing drums for us, and we didn't have a bass player one week. He's like, yeah, I play the bass. I can play the bass. I trusted him. He's a good kid. And so he came and played the bass, and it was not great. And that was kind of a conversation where I had with him, where I'm like, Raya, I love you. If you want to come play bass with us some more, you can work on it. We're not going to pay you to do it. Like, if I'm going to pay someone to play bass, I'm going to pay a good bass player. But if you want to come and, like, grow in your skill on that, we can find someone to mentor you. We can, but he had some skills, but they weren't there. So that was kind of our role at my last church. We paid, if we felt like there's something we needed that we didn't have. Like, our preference is always to have someone within the church. And if it had been electric guitar, we probably would have said, like, we're not going to pay for an electric guitar. Like, that's... The icing on the cake is really nice, but the important part is the cake. Maybe you feel differently about cake, but that's kind of how I'd... Like, Jake, who's playing with us this week, he's like, I'm the cherry on top. Like, he kind of gets what his role is. Like, he knows he's not, like, essential, but he's, like, the fun part on top, which he tends to be. Yeah. So we tend to... And my current church now, we don't just have money to pay people, so we don't. And people have been, like, surprisingly helped, like, wanting to jump in. So Brooke, who's playing piano for us this weekend, at my previous church, we paid Brooke. She was hired before I was to be the worship leader when they were starting contemporary worship. They said, we need someone to hold this whole thing together. And so they found Brooke and brought her in. And she didn't want to be the worship leader. She just kind of, like, held things together. And so after I left, separate from me leading my last church, Brooke left. And then we're starting this new church. And Brooke could be... getting paid lots of money on a Sunday to play worship, to lead worship. Instead, she wants to be with us because we're her friends, and our lead pastor's a friend of hers, and it's just been really awesome. But people have been really willing to give up their time. And that's something I've learned, actually, in the last year and a half of, like, because my inclination is to be like, I will find some money, come play with me, I'll give you money to do it. And people are really giving of their time when you ask them to. And sometimes that is that creativity that comes from our boundaries of who can I talk to, who are my friends, who can I... But my last church, our philosophy was kind of like, if we're inviting someone into our church, we're going to honor their gift by giving them a little bit of something, even though it wasn't much. But, all right, I think we spent a lot. Any other questions? Ready to move on? Everybody feeling good? All right. So the second part of that definition, the second part they talk about in the idea of worship is careful preparation. It is also preparation for the many dimensions of worship. So my phrase, singing a song of truth in the same key at the same time, talks about songs, and that tends to be what we talk about when we talk about worship. Excuse me. But really what I'm talking about is, what kind of art are we using on Sunday morning? What kind of things are we inviting people in to use to worship who God is? So it is more than just picking songs. It is more than just saying, these are the three songs I like, let's do them today. It might be telling a story. So this morning, so last night at our worship service, you may or may not picked up, we wanted to talk about the Holy Spirit. So John was talking about, and so we wanted to talk about the work of the Holy Spirit. So we started with a song that is directly about the Holy Spirit. We didn't start in the way I would normally, like normally, especially if like a conference, I'd be like, all right, guys, first song, big and loud, get people standing up, really energized for the weekend. That's kind of like always my go-to of like, first song should be big, everyone should get excited. And we started a little not big last night. We started a little down and quiet and invited people into the work of the Holy Spirit. This morning, I really wanted to talk about God's story. So we began with our God, which talks about water you turned into wine. Our God is bigger. Our God is stronger. And we ended it with a song that I'm sorry I wasn't on the PowerPoint. I don't know what happened to that. And that kind of style song at work because you had a simpler part. Yeah. But it does talk about who died for us, who rose again, death could not win, our God alone. And so it was a good kind of began and end that this morning with those stories and then kind of coming back into the story of Revelation of God is coming back. And that's kind of with our story this morning. It's more than just picking the five songs you like. Do you have a diversity of voices on your team? What I love about having Brooke on my team is, one, Brooke has a very unique voice. Brooke is a tenor. For being a female, she's got a really deep and low voice, and she is gorgeous. If she had a more normal female range, she'd be too famous for me to be her friend. And so I'm somewhat thankful for that. I know it's also, anyway, won't go into that. But allowing, finding ways, and actually this is something, a struggle for me, because on Sunday mornings, I really like leading worship, and I don't often, and I have a shortage of time, and so a lot of time my default is like, these are four songs, I'm going to lead all of them, Brooke's going to sing harmony, and Brooke loves singing harmony, so I know I'm not offending Brooke, but I also know I need to bring in more voices into what we're doing, and so it's being more careful about how we do that, and there's, because Brooke and I have played together a long time, we have places like where we trade off, and we know you're going to do this, and I'm going to do this, and we kind of do that well. Worship with all five senses. We tend to not be super liturgical in the covenant. We have pockets of high church that happen, but rarely do we ever see like places we use our sense of smell in worship. I've been a few times to near my in-laws in South Dakota. There's a small monastery, an abbey that we visited, and the times I've been there and they've lit incense, and that fills the room, as actually makes me more aware of the worship. Even when I don't know what's happening in the rest of the worship service, because I don't speak Latin or I can't follow the liturgy they use, that heightened sense of like the spirit filling the place that fills my nose draws you in. If we can use more senses, you can draw people in. I know a church that did, the pastor's talking about the bread of life, and they set up like those little those homemade like bread maker machines around the church. So as the church service is happening, they're talking about the bread of life. I know. Well, and you've got to serve bread at the end of that, right? Like you've got to have. You can't just like leave people wanting bread and then not fulfill that. But it's just to get people thinking in a different way. And it's what I love about those kind of things are they're not things you like hit people over the head with, where it's like, hey guys, you're going to smell bread in a minute, okay? What it means is I'm talking about how we want to have the bread of life. No, it's just like there's just smell in the church that is pervasive, and we're not banging people over the head with like, hey guys, we're hitting the theme. Do you hear it? We're hitting the theme.
So would a smoke machine be the same as like the incense?
It could be. Why not? Yeah. I know some churches that use smoke machines to very good use, and as some churches, you know, most churches are horrible. Yeah. Yeah. And this is what I've been told the point of smoke machines are, is that you see your light. Like, that's the point of the smoke machine. It's not, the smoke is not the point, it's that so you see you see this beam of light. So if you can use that to your advantage. One of the things, a bigger kind of thing that's happening, if you are on Facebook seeing other churches, is this move to like a stage design at churches, where they're building really cool sets, and but it's just another visual representation that draws us in, you know. And again, it's you work within the creativity of your space and of your budget. So at our church right now, we're in a coffee shop. We set up and tear down every week. We, beyond what's on the projector, don't have the time, the money, or the storage space to do much more than that. The last church I was at, we met in a gym, and so we spent a lot of time trying to, like, how do we make this space look less like a gym? And so we built some cool stage designs, had some volunteers that did that. But even in our church now, we just built a new, it's our communion table, but it's made out of, like, old barnwood. And it just has kind of this whitewashed look to it. And for us to be in a place that is a brick coffee shop, to have this piece that kind of is something that draws us in, it's really simple. It also serves as storage, which is awesome. So we keep all of our cables and cords in there throughout the week. So we needed more places to put those. And the cross we kept breaking is in there because that's protected. But it gives us something to look at beyond what's already there. Can we find ways to use poetry and prose in our services? We have a writer in our church, and using his gift to kind of like, whether it's writing a prayer or even just sharing a story he's written, there's lots of different ways to invite those kind of people into our service. And do we have a depth of emotion, all the emotions? We tend to think of church on Sunday mornings as being happy all the time. Like, let's smile, let's be. So I used to tell my worship team, hey guys, can you smile during worship? Because in Minnesota, most people are good choir singers, and so they tend to like hold their folder and look down, not express themselves. And I've moved to saying, like, it's not about smiling all the time. It's about expressing a proper emotion, right? Like, as the worship team, we are standing in front of people trying to invite them to worship. Can we express an appropriate emotion at the time? And our emotions should go beyond just being happy and smiling all the time. There are times in Sunday mornings, whether it's through song or prayer, to lament, to ask forgiveness. We shouldn't be smiling. Maybe we shouldn't be smiling when we're doing a prayer for forgiveness on Sunday mornings.
Some of it should just be emotion at all. Just some sort of, invite them to make some sort of expression.
Yeah. Don't just hold your mic and look at the music. That's what I really try hard to do. Like there, and some people still don't get it. And it's hard for me too, because I'm the one up there like closing my eyes, just like doing this thing, and I'm trying to get better. I have a daughter who's 2, and she does that at home. So she grabs a harmonica. Like, we have a little toy harmonica, and she'll just go, it's making noise. Anyway, sorry.
I just wondered, do you incorporate theater or, declaiming word or acting out word or prayer? Or
yes. I have not often had people who are really gifted in that, and so there's occasions where we've done it. But it's never been, I've never had the people to do, let's do this regularly. But yeah, to have, whether it's like a drama or yeah, even just to have like a monologue of someone come up and share.
We just like, it's hard to find. Like, yeah. Skits tend to be really flat. But we've noticed that like maybe in one morning someone could memorize a scripture and actually give it as its monologue, the way that it was intended. Or we've had moments where we just have time where we visualize what answered prayer looks like. And we have people just showing a picture to people as to what that prayer might look like.
Yeah.
So it doesn't have to be like skits where you memorize lines and have actors and things like that.
That's awesome.
I think that it helps too with some of the emotions and is to encourage your musicians and your singers to be more intentional to memorize the chords and memorize the words instead of being so fixated on. We have a screen that faces the stage. And
yep.
It makes it a little easier. They're not quite looking down. But then you have to make sure that your person who's running the pro presenter is on.
Yes.
Line.
Yes.
There's nothing worse than trusting the pro presenter and all of a sudden explaining like, wow.
Yeah, hold on a second. Yeah.
So, we are intentional about making sure that the person who runs the pro presenter is at rehearsal.
Yep.
And, we tell them when you get to the last line of that, go ahead and go.
Yep.
And then that means you have to know what's next. That
yep.
means you have to learn the songs just as much as a musician.
I think there's a setting on Pro Presenter. You can have 2 slides up.
You can.
So you can have the next one and the current one.
But then if you jump back to slide 1, they have to be able to do that too.
So. Yeah, having that kind of, that backstage.
So the more preparation you do in rehearsal, to me, it helps you to be more of a worship leader instead of just playing a song.
Yeah. Yeah, in that sense, part of my thing too is I'm not great at memorizing things, especially the guitar chords. Like the words are fine, but they remember the guitar chords for me. And even if I know them, like I'm so drawn to just like looking at the music. It's just like a security blanket of, especially when the congregation is close to me. Like if I was leading worship right here, I would not want to be looking at you people because it'd make me uncomfortable. So I'd be looking at my music, or I'd be closing my eyes. But it's just like, But that does talk, like what you're saying, like it takes preparation to do that. So a lot of times, like we're thinking, like I'm just going to throw it together on Saturday. We can't call someone on Saturday and say, memorize these 10 verses tomorrow. Right, tomorrow. It takes knowing, and that is for me. Like it took coaching my last church, coaching my pastor to say, like I really need more from you. Like I love that you write your sermons on Saturdays and give them on Sunday. Great, but I need to know. I'd love to know 6 weeks from now what you're talking about, and have it be what you actually talk about. Like that's the thing for us. It happens a lot.
And for me this morning, the most effective moment was when he was sharing the story about the congregant that came up and shared, and said that hearing you say that I love you every morning.
Yeah.
That thing that struck all of us. And and there have been times, too, where the worship leader, the pastor, just says, this week we're going to be hearing about God's love. I know someone who has a really good story to tell about that.
Yeah.
Maybe instead of the song, I approach that person, they just write a 2-minute story about how that acted out and tell it to us. And that was very effective, too, in worship. You just go to that person, ask them to tell their story for the congregation.
Yeah.
When you do worship, do you have 1 or 2 people bringing sound in the projector?
We usually have 2.
Right.
Not always, but usually 1 for each.
Yeah, I'm a sound technician, and I primarily run both.
Yeah.
And if there's something wrong, it can be a challenge. So recently, I've been recruiting people to train on so that way if something does go wrong, it goes smoothly. Plus, I want to jump the video. I'm more of a video producer.
Okay.
Because that's my real job, but I don't mind being a sound guy. So, trying to form this legit team.
Yeah.
I want to make sure the sound stuff
goes
smooth.
There was one church I was leading at in my free agency tour that would have no one there, like during rehearsal, like no sound. Like this, like the pastor would turn the sound system on, and there'd be no sound guy there the whole. Like I'm running back, it's set, and you can do it, but it's not fun. And I really find like running the pro presenter, the PowerPoint, is a great like entry level volunteer role because it doesn't take like running sound. I feel like takes a lot of skill of like. I mean, I can teach any monkey to turn the knobs, but to like hear what you're supposed to hear and mix it well takes a lot of skill. But to say like we're doing the projector, follow the worship team along, hit the arrow button, I feel like that take is a pretty entry level.
Something I try to promote when we recruit volunteers and we train them is when they show up on Sunday that everything's ready. Like, we make sure that all the slides are exactly right.
Yeah.
The spelling's right. It tells them, man, their work area is clean.
Yeah.
Where they're gonna sit. And then we have time. We need you to at such and such a time.
Yeah.
You need to be sitting down, ready to go. We actually drew just recently.
Yeah.
Wrote up a whole long list of. Processes for Wednesday nights, for
rehearsal
Wednesday nights, for something, and we give that to the people who work in every different area, so you know this is what's expected.
Yeah,
and that helps people too. But to have it ready when they show up.
Yeah. Well, that's the part. The flip side of that for me is empowering people to know, like, either if I sing the wrong word, either like it's okay for you to tell me, Tim, you messed that up, or we can have the conversation about, oh, could you change that because this is the word I want to sing. Or to empower them to say, like, hey, I think this you misspelled this, or this is wrong, like, change it.
You
like
you, that in rehearsal.
Yeah, we get it in rehearsal, we get it, yeah, so it's not happening Sunday morning in the service.
Yeah, I know we switched to tech, but
yeah.
I wanted to
Let's go back.
Back to what you were talking about with the R and the pros of bringing things in, and you said, well, you can't, because it takes so much preparation, you can't do it regularly.
I think you. I'll say that happened for me. Like, not that it took. That wasn't. Yeah, I think you can. But anyway, go ahead.
Well, what I was going to say, my point was that we've had this summer that have a huge positive impact if it isn't regularly.
Yeah.
If it's occasionally, it gets in people's heads and they remember it.
Yeah.
So I don't think it's a negative if you can't do it regularly. If you can recruit people to do this, then that's not a bad thing because we remember those things that are unusual.
Yeah.
We don't remember the things that we see day after day after day after day. And so that's a good thing. And one of the things that we do for the worship with all five senses is that our in our kind of arty, whatever you want to call it, is get audience participation. So maybe you have stations around and you actually get them up out of their chairs and go do something. And those are so memorable. People, the positive response you get from that. But you don't do it every month. You might do it 4 times a year or something, and it makes a much better response. So if you're planning ahead for things that you want to involve the five senses and you want to do some already things, you don't worry about that you can't do it often.
Well, and the other part too is the participation thing, again, that there are a lot of people who want to be part of it, but they're not musicians, and that allows the dancers to see the drama people, the visual artists.
I brought a couple of books I like, there's one called For the Beauty of the Church that is a bunch of essays on creativity in church, and most of it is non-musical art. And really, when I read this, really struck me is that if you are a musician in a church, it's easy to find a role for you. If you are anything else, it is hard. Like if you're a painter, potter, theater, like any of that kind of stuff, it's really hard to find a place for you in the church. But it's to have those kind of opportunities. Fantastic, and people do remember it. It's very impactful. And then it's the kind of, for me, it was helpful when it was impactful to go to my senior pastor and say, see, because we had the time to prepare for this really thing happened, so can I have more time to prepare? David O. Taylor, W. David O. Taylor. So he edited it. It is essays like Eugene Peterson, Lauren Winter, Andy Crouch, Joshua Banner, a bunch of different people in there. So, yeah. For the Beauty of the Church.
In my role as director of Pulse, I see all the comments that come from everybody in every church that we do about worship and what are the things that, and as we talked about culture this morning, you know, in the culture shift, what we see pop up as far as the complaints about worship tend to run, one, the whole culture of what does it mean to have this holy space, you know, and we have different generations who think differently. So you may be surprised by this, but one of the most common comments we get is, people bring coffee into the sanctuary.
Yeah.
And you probably heard it before.
Yep.
And because some people see this, well, this is kind of like my living room, and other people who have been taught saying, no, this is the place where God lives. And
yeah.
So, you know, as you think about vitality and the ideas of worship, that's one of the things that every church has to struggle with. Another one is the music style.
Yeah.
Obviously, contemporary, traditional, and even in between. It's like, well, we don't sing the choruses from the 80s and 90s. You know, it's not, we don't sing the old hymns. It's, we don't sing the songs that we like to do, that we used to do. So there's nostalgia, even contemporary music.
Yep.
And then the other one obviously revolves around the worship leader. Either people like them or they don't. And that can be because of the musical talent of the person. It's one thing to start a church in Minneapolis where you have lots and lots of great musicians.
Yep.
It's another thing to start a new church, you know, or be in a revitalization situation in a small town, rural area. Where do you find musicians to lead your worship? It's a big challenge. And finding a worship leader, and sometimes it's about personality, sometimes it's about the person's singing voice and, you know, the cringe factors that we've all experienced in worship. Mm-hmm. You're like, ow. And if that's happening quite often, people start getting uncomfortable.
Yeah.
So all of those things are things in your culture. You all have your stories to tell about worship, but as you think about getting to healthy missional, those are some of the things that I'll have to be addressed.
All right. And I want to, so that your first two points I want to talk about quick. We have about 10 minutes left, so I'm going to move a little quickly through. We're going to skip some stuff because it's not, anyway. We talk about like the beer and coffee and then kind of contemporary versus traditional. First off, like John said this morning, heartfelt worship is not a code word for contemporary worship. Heartfelt worship doesn't mean you have to change your style to something it's not. And then I really think the question is, how does your congregation want to engage with God's story? And a lot of that comes down to this idea of like, well, is the sanctuary like my living room, or is the sanctuary a place that is set apart and is the Holy of Holies? And those are both valid ways to view that space. And that tells you a lot about how your congregation wants to interact with the Word. It tells you a lot about your congregation about how they want to, is it primarily a place where I'm looking to the pastor as the priest and we are more of in a horizontal style of worship and we're going to send these up together, or is it more of vertical where I'm accessing God directly from the place that I feel comfortable? And that tells you a lot about your church and where you want to go with your worship. When you're understanding your congregation, also knowing when to push your congregation's comfort zone. I'm guessing that's going to be something to think about a lot for a lot of you. As you think about moving towards heartfelt worship, how hard and how fast can we push? I'm going to talk briefly about millennials and about a couple years ago for a history class, I did a study of when the Covenant Church switched from being primarily in Swedish to being in English. And I found this really great quote that I liked. It said, for the first time, some of them heard the gospel preached and hymns sung in a language of every day. They discovered experientially that the language of faith could be the same one they used in school and on the job. And this is what caused the Covenant Church to switch from being a Swedish church to being an English-speaking church, where, especially in World War I, a lot of young Covenant Swedish kids went off to fight war, and they went to chapel there, and they're like, oh, I can worship God in English. Like, I don't have to speak. And really, like, the Swedish language they were speaking was, like, a really, like, they called it Swenglish. Like, it was, like, this really mixed-up version of Swedish that nobody in Sweden spoke anymore. And there is something about, can we worship God in a language that I worship God with every other day? There's also the flip side of, there are times to worship God in a language that is foreign to me, that pushes me to something new. everyone's always trying to be, everybody's talking about the millennials, basically born 1980 to 2000. I'm technically a millennial, but I don't think I am. And there's some quick stuff out of this study called The Millennials by Tom and Jess Rayner out of Lifeway Research. And they said there's three keys for worship. They did not specifically ask worship questions in this big study they did on millennials, but they kind of came up with these three themes. Millennials desire to have rich content in the services. Millennials desire to have authenticity. And this generation does not put quality first. So really, in response to maybe the baby boomer generation that came before them, I think we've talked a little bit about kind of rich content this morning. That is people who are, so basically millennials now are like college age through young 30s. You're probably, a lot of people asking the question of like, why aren't young people in my church? And these are some three things to begin to ask. Does our music and our service have rich content? Are we authentic? Or are we putting on a show? And are we putting the quality of that show ahead of having rich content and having authenticity? Not that we shouldn't be good or strive for quality, but it's not their primary concern in worship, which I found really fascinating because I just did. All right. So we talked about what worship is a response, how, through careful preparation, and we're going to spend a little bit of time here as we close on the why. So this is what, again, was said. The third point in kind of the covenant's discussion of heartfelt worship, people leave knowing something more about the heart of God and their own hearts. This is, for me, a vision about why we worship. So we have, like, this is what we do, this is how we do it, this is why we do it. We do it for the outcome. We do it so that people leave on Sunday mornings knowing something more about the heart of God and their own hearts. I want to talk quick. The Shema, you may have heard it before. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one, the Lord alone. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and all your might. And this is the kind of the second half of this is the part that I really want to hit this morning. Keep these words that I'm commanding you today in your heart. Recite them to your children. Talk about them when you're at home and when you're away, when you lie down and when you rise. Bind them as a sign on your hand. Fix them as an emblem on your forehead. And write them on the doorposts of your house and your gates. For me, this is about the symbols we use to point to God and the reminders we set up. So I love that people on Wednesday morning are singing the song that we sang on Sunday. That is my goal, is to sing songs that are earworms. So that on Wednesday night, when you're having a hard time, you're going to be singing, Holy Spirit, you're welcome here. Like, it's going to be in your head. What are the ways we are building for our church and our congregation? Things that point us back to God. And then the second one, this is one of my favorite verses on worship from Philippians 4, 8, and 9. Finally, beloved, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there's anything of excellence, and if there's anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Keep on doing the things you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, and the God of peace will be with you. Our worship should be something that points to God's beauty in everyday life, something that as we leave, it's not just something that happens in this building once an hour, but it points us to something outside the building. So really, I think part of this is about evaluation. So the question, I think they relate to what John talked about last night. What did I learn about God's heart today, or what is the Holy Spirit doing in our community? What did God teach me today about my own heart? What is the Holy Spirit doing in me? This is actually something I was thinking about last night that is a new practice I'm starting on Monday, actually, is emailing my worship team like a couple of these questions. Just in his evaluation, because if our whole point, the reason we're meeting is so that people experience God and his story, learn something more about God and about themselves, let's see if that's happening. So that's actually like my new thing. I like the questions John had this morning about our worship. What does God want us to preserve? What does God want us to create? What does God want us to discard? I was typing furiously as John was talking this morning. So I think as you're thinking about revitalization in your church, really, like I was telling John the other day, like I just took a class on managing church change in seminary, and I'm like, mostly I just want to come up and tell you all those things because it's the same for your worship service as it is for like your entire church. But if you think about your worship services, and no matter what, you may be a healthy missional church is out there, and they should be asking these questions: What is it about how we worship that God wants us to preserve? What are the things that we just can't do without? because that's unique to your church, and you should preserve those things, and you should fight tooth and nail for them. It might be your organ and your organist, even though people tell you that, well, we need to get rid of the organ and get somebody with a guitar up there. It might be your building, it might not be your building, it might be all those things, but what are the things we need to create, and what does God want us to discard? I think I'm getting close to the end. So I just want to give you guys talk about a few resources that are out there. The first is this. Why is it doing? I didn't set it up like this, but I guess here it is. The first is this Better Together worship page on Facebook. Join us. You can friend me. I will be your friend on Facebook. Tim Coyer. You can find me, and just say, "Hey Tim, I was in your class. Can you get me into the Better Together group?" I will get you in. Usually, so I'm not an administrator, but we'll tell one of the administrators, like, hey, there's this person. Tell me what church you're from and what your role is. But we tend to kind of, like I said, focus on worshipy people, not necessarily like lead pastors. If you're the lead pastor and you're like the only pastor and worshipy things are your job, then you're welcome. But just, yeah, worshipy people. Some of these resources, I'm guessing a lot of you use some of these things. Song Select through CCLI, if you're looking just for worship songs, it's a service you can add on. If you're not a member of CCLI and you're singing contemporary worship songs, you really should, because it pays the people who write all the songs, and you should keep paying them. Chris Tomlin might have enough money, but not everybody else does. And Song Select is a service where you can just find the songs and find the chords and put it in the key you want it in. Like that. It's fantastic. And it merges with Planning Center Online. Planning Center Online is a great tool for planning your worship services. It allows you to plan ahead. You can put all your music files on there, all your PDFs of your chord charts, also like MP3s of everything. So you can tell people, like, hey, Monday morning, service is done for next week. There's music, there's MP3s, they have a great app. Listen to those songs before Thursday night when you come to rehearsal. For us, rehearsal is not the time we come and learn new songs. It is the time we come and polish them for Sunday morning. So it gives us a tool to say, go online, listen to the songs. It costs you a little bit of money based on how big your church is. I think it's worth it. And it's not just for big churches. I think some people go we're not big enough for that. It is really helpful for a church of all volunteers so that you can connect together.
It makes it easier for the worship leader too.
Yeah. Find a YouTube that you like, or
just
yep.
Say everybody go to the same
place, and it's there. I'm part time at my church. I don't have time to send 10 emails. I just do it once and send it out. Planning people is really easy. They can go in a calendar option and say I'm gone this month. So it doesn't allow you to schedule them. It's fantastic. Yeah, there's an iPad app where you can just have the music on there. Does that all? Yeah. We're there 2 hours before the service. Partially, we have to set everything up. But tomorrow, we still run. Thursday night is let's get all these, the song, but let's learn how, we're figuring out how we're going to play it together, and let's do it. Sunday morning for me is about transitions mostly. So let's get together, and I'm going to be all right. Last night we did Holy Spirit, and I really wanted to go straight into the next song, You Make Me Brave. And so it's we spent 20 minutes on that transition of, I don't want to have a downtime of everybody tunes, everybody pages their pedal settings. So we worked on that transition. That's what we do a lot on Sunday mornings. And for me, that's I'm going to practice saying the call to worship. And then you're going to practice starting the song while I'm doing that. So just Sunday mornings are more about transitions for us. iTunes. I can't tell you how many times I was I want to sing a song about the Holy Spirit, but I'm not thinking of any good ones. And I type Holy Spirit into iTunes search, and a song I'd forgotten about pops up. It's just crazy. And hymnals. Who's forgot about your hymnal? Our hymnals are great resources. The Covenant Book of Worship is a great resource for prayers and all that kind of stuff. And then I just have a list of some books that I was looking at my shelf last night going, what books have I read about worship that really have impacted me? So Ancient Future Worship, I did have on my shelf, I couldn't find it. Robert Weber, really a classic about worship. For the Beauty of the Church, I already mentioned, by David Taylor. Really about a vision for the arts outside of music in your church. The Divine Commodity by Sky Jathani. What's the subtitle? Discovering a Faith Beyond Consumer Christianity. Really interesting book about it starts with him at a, I'm not sure if it's Willow Creek, but some kind of huge church worship conference, and almost getting sick to his stomach. and going like, well, there's got to be a better vision for our church than just like come in and hear a lot of fancy songs and go. Worship Evangelism by Sally Morgenthaler, another great book, Inviting Unbelievers into the Presence of God. The Liturgical Year by Joan Chichester, both personal and congregational ideas of how do you incorporate the liturgical year into what you're doing. When I think about adding rich content to our services, I think a lot about the liturgical year. We are not liturgical at our church, but we are celebrating All Saints Day tomorrow. We do talk about Advent, and we do talk about Lent, and it gives another layer. We don't do it legalistically, or we don't do it, we're not following the lectionary texts, but we follow that season. And then I had two books that are really, these are on just congregational change. Congregational Leadership in Anxious Times by Peter Stanky, really kind of saying, without a little anxiety, we don't make change. And how as you leader, how do you control and manage and anxiety? And then Leading Congregational Change by Jim Harrington and a couple others. These are guys who actually are in their Baptists down in Houston and really did a revitalization movement within their conference of churches around Houston. And this is them talking about how they did it and what they did. But those are some of the books that I would share with you guys today. Questions? Comments? I think that's everything. I had more stuff in case we ran it because I was too fast and you guys were great. But it wasn't as great as what we already talked about. Thank you all this morning for sharing with you. You ever need me, tim.coyer@gmail.com. Shoot me an email. Be happy to chat with you if you have questions about your church and what's going on there. So, cool. So I guess it's lunchtime, and I'm supposed to remind you if you are a church chairman, there's the church chairman's lunch today. So, thank you.